urge to innovate, to create breakthrough products is deep, almost uncontrollable at Intel. The company shelled out about $1.1 billion on R&D in 1994 and another $2.4 billion in capital spending to deliver on CEO Andy Grove's commitment to make the fastest chips in the newest applications. The company takes huge risks, swinging for a home run with each product. When one engineering team chalks up a win, another one sets out to knock the legs out from under it with a better product. Birth and death. Innovation and obsolescence are part of the daily life at Intel. Says John Crawford, Intel's constant push to innovate is a result of a combination of technical curiosity on our part, encouragement by upper management, and forces of the marketplace. One technology factor is the constant impulse towards ever smaller devices, ever faster devices, larger dies, that is, chip sizes, an ever-increasing transistor budget, that is, the number of transistors on a chip, and higher megahertz, which is the chip speed. It is a fascinating thing. You are on a treadmill. You have to innovate or you will be out of business. If we were doing warmed-over Ford 86s instead of Pentiums, we would be in good shape today, but a year or two down the road, the product would start to look pretty passé. Says Albert Yu, it is interesting to know that we are the ones who are generating the waves, if you will. Others are not. The waves are the new generation of products, and the Pentium chip is the new wave that is just starting. It could be that we will be initiating the next generation wave by 1995 or 1996. We are never satisfied, and we are most critical of ourselves. It is a never-ending drive to do better work, and complacency is the farthest thing from our minds. Says Jerry Parker, the Pentium chip was among the most difficult chips that we have ever had to manufacture. Its manufacturing shows how far towards the limit Intel pushes technology. It is a huge chip, at the physical limit of the lithography tools which put transistors in their connections on silicon. Because of the chip size and the performance required, we had to stretch the technology further than we liked. Not that this is anything totally new. When we started the 386, that too was at the limit of our capability, and the 486 wasn't much better when we introduced it. Fortunately, though, as painful as it has been, we are able to handle the Pentium, and we are getting good yields in production. Sustaining product leadership involves some pain, because no sooner does management bless one portfolio of development projects than market and technology trends accelerate, slow, or sprint off in another direction. The project portfolio, a shrewd and sensible collection of concepts when it was constructed, blows apart. Then, in a fit of re-evaluation, managers pit existing projects against each other and against new concepts from outside the company to build a new portfolio. Says Dennis Carter, people at the executive staff level pay a lot of attention to outside input. We listen to the field and go out on visits with ears open to hear what is actually happening. We read the roll-up of information as it comes in and discuss it in the group, with the idea of possibly shaping some new directions for the company. Says Jerry Parker, right now the big dilemma is that while we have a strong share of our market segments in central processing units and in desktop computers, trends in the world seem to be pointing in a different direction towards information appliances. Is the TV going to be the next home computer? We don't think so. Says Albert Yu, Intel has a lot of flexibility to focus on new directions. For example, we had been in the microprocessor business since the 1970s, but it wasn't the mainstream of the corporation. Andy Grove, our CEO, is the one who decided that the future was in microprocessors. We made a strategic shift from memory to microprocessors in 1985. Right now, Andy's vision is taking us into communications. We are developing a lot of communications capability, and my guess is that in 5 years or less, we will be a major force in computers and communications. Andy always has a tremendous sense of urgency, and his personal drive drives all of us. I do sometimes review how we allocate our resources, what percentage of our total resources go to what. I'm afraid we don't always put enough into the new areas, by which I mean not adding resources but diverting existing resources. It is easier to stay with the status quo, following a linear progression. Making a right angle turn can be very painful. What so distinguishes product leadership firms from most other companies today is that product leaders don't slavishly follow the voice of the customer. The customer can't define for them the next breakthrough product. Market resources can't define it either. Although product leaders like Intel stay close to the market, they listen to the astute comments of customers only to hone their own judgment of the future. Customers can help them get the details right. At Intel, the definition of the product is the first step in its development. The target may be far off, even far out, but engineers know where to direct their creative energies. That's what we mean by thinking right to left, starting with a visionary concept crafted by leading thinkers and then instructing people to fire the arrows of their imagination straight to the target, not just anywhere into the future. Says Jerry Parker, since we are a product leader, we are always described in the press as being an innovator. That's true. But innovation at Intel needs careful definition. When people talk about classic innovation, I always think about 3M. People at 3M are geared to invent one crazy thing after another. At Intel, the challenge is different. We also have a lot of bright people who want to innovate in totally new directions. But they often don't understand that we have set a course that keeps us ahead of the market in computers and computer communications. We are essentially innovating to solve a very specific problem, not just any problem. We are not a think tank of innovation for its own sake. We are making a product. To translate an idea into a product, you try to imagine the next logical step in the progression. What features does the market want, and what can you put into your product? What will the technology allow you to do? By answering such questions, you basically define a product. To make sure that manufacturing is preparing for the future, we look at a product and continually update it. We focus on what we think is going to happen. We are trying now to develop a model of what a future PC requires in total, what kind of components. The crucial element is trying to anticipate the demand 5 years out, both ours and for the rest of the PC market. We need innovation, but a directed, disciplined innovation aimed at solving very specific problems. Even with the original microprocessor invention, Ted Hoff was trying to figure out a better way to make a calculator programmable. It was innovation to solve a specific problem we faced. Says Albert Yu, one interesting process is trying to foresee what is going to be needed by the time we develop the successor to the Pentium processor. No one knows for sure, of course. We talk about those questions with a lot of software people, customers, end users, and so forth. From that, we have a pretty good idea of what a next chip should be like. I should note that once we had completed the Pentium processor, we redefined who our customers are. Traditionally, our customers were only those original equipment manufacturers that buy products from us. That is a shallow view. The real customers are the final users of the computers that incorporate our products. As a result, we established a very close link to our customer's customer that gave us direct contact with our end users as well as with our traditional OEM customer. That policy has given us some new ideas from the outside. Our traditional customers give us a tremendous amount of input in terms of the architecture of the product. The end users give us a lot of input about the more global things that they want to have in the product. Says Dennis Carter, information from end users has resulted in many product modifications, though seldom of a major or structural kind. We know what we want the architecture of our next generation microprocessors to look like, but beyond that, we'd like to know what users will find useful. Feedback gives us options for fine-tuning and for making things fit better. The field people came up with so much information that the factory people had a hard time evaluating all of it. Therefore, we put in place an information technology board of advisors, a dozen information technology managers from Fortune 500 companies who meet about 2 or 3 times a year. We spend a couple of days with them, presenting product plans in depth and soliciting their feedback. That allows us to get very focused information on things that would normally be under non-disclosure. It also allows us to bring product planning people, marketer, engineer, or both, from the factory to meet with real users and get a direct response to our plans. It's a good way of coordinating information from the field, expert evaluation, and our internal views. Says Jerry Parker, with everything beginning to be tied in with communications technology, the feeling is that we have to move our horsepower towards meeting that challenge. Coming up with the kinds of products that will be successful in this new area calls for innovation, of course, but again, market-driven innovation. There is a lot of trial and error in that part of the business and more product innovation as well. It tends to be driven by what we perceive the customers want and what it takes to make the computer more useful. Product leadership pivots on technology, of course. So as technology advances at a faster clip, so too must product leaders' pace of innovation. leaders like Intel have hardened themselves to the chest-pounding rhythm of innovating year in and year out. They have accustomed themselves to the occasional tailwinds and downhill stretches that give people a chance to catch their breath in this marathon, but they also have prepared themselves for the long uphill climbs and the final push to the finish. That's life in the endless contest for product leadership. Says Dennis Carter, "The fast change of our technology drives the pace. We tend to move and think at a tempo unknown in other companies. Products are achieved, go through their life cycles, grow obsolete, and are replaced by another product that has been gestating quietly all the while. The life cycle here is fast." Says Albert Yu, "If we have a brilliant new product idea, we can turn on a dime. We can have a new product out the door in 3 months because we are so close to the marketplace. It's not always that fast because we have our own bureaucracy to ensure a regular and orderly process, but we can also cut through that process when we need to. The development of the Intel DX2 microprocessor, a member of the Intel 486 family, was a classic example of putting a project on the fast track." Says John Crawford, "It's challenging and exciting to work in this environment, particularly with this double the performance every 18-month challenge we are faced with. If we had the same kind of progress in the automotive industry, we would be driving 11,000 miles per hour faster than in 1982. We'd fly from L.A. to New York in 6 seconds instead of 6 hours. This performance treadmill can get stressful at times, so the challenge is to keep from being burned out by it. One thing that helps here at Intel is the satisfaction of knowing that millions of people have liked your product well enough to buy it. The calming effect of that knowledge helps relieve the stress." Says Albert Yu, "Keeping everyone focused over the long development time of the Pentium processor was a difficult challenge. It was like running a marathon and realizing halfway through that you are very tired. Oddly enough, the most difficult time is not during the process, it is afterwards, when you suddenly feel empty. I think that the excitement is so great during the development that all of us are physically tired but mentally accelerated. People see themselves making history, and it's true. Every member of the team is helping to write new technological history. The tough part of it is when things are not going well. At those times, we have to take some time off and then come back recharged." Says John Crawford, "One of the leadership roles I contributed to was in the later phases of designing the Pentium. What happens in the last 6 months of development is the final push to get the things done even as others are talking about the next generation. We had launched the team in Oregon to build a more advanced microprocessor, and they were coming up with ideas of what they could do with their transistor budget. They were making good progress toward another leap in functionality and performance from that product, and a lot of the new research was already bearing fruit for the next generation. The shine of the Pentium processor was beginning to pale in comparison to the gleam in the engineers' eyes for the generations to come, so I helped keep our team focused in getting the Pentium product to market." Says Albert Yu, "Designing the chip is actually the simpler part of creating a new microprocessor. The harder part is to ensure that it runs on the software that runs the previous generation processor, and a check for compatibility turns out to be the bigger task than the design effort itself. The technical challenge is enormous. The task is similar to that of software development, in which coding is a very small part of the problem. It is the testing to make sure there are no bugs that is the main software concern." Says John Crawford, "In a commercial enterprise, you want to take calculated risks to get a shrewd balance between the size of the risk and the benefits of the results. If you take risks on all fronts, you're dead. At my level, we take risks to get more out of our transistor budget or to shorten the time to market. Greater risk usually translates into a larger design effort. Some of the risks we take are to be more productive. We could, for instance, take a chance that would help cut our time to market. A good many of our important risk decisions involve using a new computer technique that promises extra performance. We can quantify the benefits as much as possible by saying that, if we succeed, it will improve the performance of this suite of applications by, say, 15%. But there will be costs. The die size will be 20% larger, it will take more design time, and does X more hours to complete a program. That means we go to market that much later. So is it worth it?" Says Dennis Carter, "From my personal experience, I feel encouraged to take risks. I have never felt punished for a failure that occurred simply because I took a calculated chance against the odds. If it was poorly executed, however, that's another story. Then I must accept the blame. The Intel Insight campaign was extremely risky. We spent a lot of money and laid ourselves open to a possible negative reaction. Moving from print advertising, which we had done for years, to TV, which we had never done, was risky. Picking a small Salt Lake City ad agency with limited TV ad experience was a big risk, and some people let me know it. The risks at Intel get spread around. That's not to say that nobody there is accountable. The reverse is true. Every individual on a variety of cross-functional teams makes a commitment to the success of the project. Intel has become particularly seasoned in guiding the progress of large teams, the kind necessary to figure out how to fit millions of transistors into less than a thimbleful of space. Such complexity demands coordination of an unprecedented kind, one of the biggest demands imposed on a product leader like Intel. Says Albert Yu, the trick is to pull together as a total corporation, to look at product, manufacturing, promotion, sales, and advertising as one entity. Compare it to an orchestra made up of different instruments, but all performing one symphony together. Every player has a major role. If we are out of sync, we are in trouble. Says Jerry Parker, there are a lot of cross-functional teams at Intel. We have found that if we get a teams working across functions, we get better progress. They will learn from each other. We value shared learning highly. Says Dennis Carter, much of what we do is accomplished by ad hoc teams. Different parts of the company face different challenges. The technical teams, like those on the development of a long-term project, such as the Pentium processor, are of course different from those in marketing. Speaking for marketing alone, I can say that people find the teamwork invigorating. It is a consulting environment, where the program may change from week to week. Our people like being involved, and they seem to relish unexpected challenges. The team formation, and then its dissolution, is not an issue because there is always something new to move on to. Says Albert Yu, I was the general manager of the microprocessor business at the time the Pentium processor was developed. We worked in a single team all in one place. The drawback was that managing a team of 100 is quite a challenge. It took nearly as much innovation to manage the development team smoothly as it did to invent the technology. We knew from the outset that small teams tend to do well and large teams don't do well because of communication problems. To deal with this, we broke the chip into small blocks, each handled by a subgroup. Within that smaller group, communication was good. The challenges arose when inter-team communication was called for, and so we tried to draw some clear guidelines as to how teams would talk to one another. We had to be flexible about a team approach, so if one group fell behind, we could give it added support. A town meeting format basically accomplished that purpose. We had to do some shuffling around and move people to different tasks in order to make sure all pieces of the mechanism would catch up with one another. We made such decisions weekly, if needed, daily. Says John Crawford, what we had essentially was a set of overlapping teams. Each individual working on the project really belonged to a couple of different teams. The challenge for management was to organize in accordance with natural team structures, even though the makeup of a lot of the natural teams was contrary to standard organizational boundaries. For example, in the chip design team, we had logic design specialists, in circuit design specialists. The logic people worked at a more abstract level, while the circuit people got intimate with the electrons. A team of logic and circuit specialists would implement a certain piece of the chip, both working on the same geographical area. Because the logic and circuit people had different specialties, the bureaucratic tendency would be to keep them separate in two different departments, but that would set up an organizational barrier to the natural team format. So to encourage those informal teams, we had a joint management structure with a circuit manager and logic manager and a group of specialists reporting to them. If there were any negatives to this structure, they lay in too much emphasis on the geographic teams. It hindered our development of the methodology. We had a little fracturing of the design styles that we had to counteract. The trick is to get the right balance, says Jerry Parker. We also have teams assigned to process improvement projects. For example, we have teams at our factories abroad that are working to improve cycle time. One of the problems we had was the lag time in shipping wafers from Israel to Manila to the U.S. and then to a warehouse or a customer. That cycle used to take about 13 days. We had a team in each of these factories looking into why it took so long, and they worked the time down to 4 days. Every day we saved last year meant 75,000 more Intel 486 chips produced, our daily output. Elsewhere in manufacturing, we have joint engineering teams that are aimed at improving the output of the equipment and improving yields. Because people, above all, provide the basis of a product leader's success, Intel takes care not to shackle talented people in one corner or another of its organization. Instead, managers move valuable people around the organization to tackle challenges that promise to generate the most value. Managers, Intel executives concede, are the toughest to move around. But move they do, since Intel runs a pure meritocracy. People's stature and role depend on their delivering the value that assures the company's success. Says Dennis Carter, the company is designed for rapid change. We reorganize frequently and people get shuffled around a lot. Internal organizations are created, flourish, and then get dismembered. People are used to that, though, and they don't build up long-term identities with any one group. Our identities are simply with Intel. Says Kirby Dice, changes in our business drive redeployment of human resources. We are constantly moving valuable resources from lower areas of return to higher areas of return, to functions that provide higher value to our customers. When we started formal redeployment 4 years ago, we found that one of the toughest groups of people to redeploy was managers. They were used to their own organization. They were used to the structure that they had managed. One manager who was redeployed formerly had 80 to 100 people reporting to him. The need for his function went away as our business model changed. Thus, this organization wasn't adding value, and yet it was adding costs. The result was that the employees were redeployed into other positions at Intel. The last person to redeploy was the manager, who had actively helped place his people. We just didn't ignore this manager. He had done an excellent job in previous positions and now had effectively planned and executed the dismantling of his own organization and job. He was given an opportunity to start up a new organization within a different business, a major challenge, and he was successful. Says Albert Yu, the policy of moving people from one area to another is a good one because once people achieve some small amount of success at a new task, their confidence builds. The frequent transfer process has turned out to be much smoother than we originally imagined. There is the psychological problem of moving from the satisfactions of a completed project to the uncertainties of a new one, but if people really believe the future vision, they will be able to move forward. Says Dennis Carter, as for the downside, some people view the environment as chaotic, with no structure they can hang on to. They may like what they actually do, but they don't understand their role in the system, and this even applies to some managers. It is certainly true that roles are ill-defined, but our feeling is that carefully defined roles lead to a rigid and static organization. Some people are comfortable with that, some are not. On the other hand, the tasks are not ill-defined. You know precisely what your goal is on a given program or project. People who can live with a certain amount of uncertainty and yet never doubt their ultimate goal fit in well at Intel. Says Kirby Dice, we are not against demoting people at Intel. There are times when managers or employees get into positions where they are way over their heads. We confront the performance shortfall. The message isn't, okay, you're out of the door. Instead, we decide that since the manager has performed well in other positions but isn't working in this new one, we'll bring them back a grade level. Often that means the person reports to someone who was previously reporting to them. Managers have to come to grips with their own egos in these situations. We have moved some managers into different roles, sometimes back 1, 2, or 3 grade levels. Once they gain success, they often move back up the organization. The experience turns out to be a valuable one. The organization as a whole is very accepting of demotions and changes. I think the reason is because we don't have a lot of focus at Intel on grades and titles. How does Intel transfer not just people, but intelligence across the company? Mainly by coaching, says Kirby Dice. As people move around to new positions, we find that a lot of coaching is helpful. I'm a good example. I was doing startup businesses prior to coming to this job, with as many as 50 people and as few as 2 or 3. In this position, I have a huge organization. For coaching, I have been able to use my predecessor, my boss, and a couple of people on my staff. Coaching goes on throughout a company. One of the ways it crops up is during subordinate input into reviews for managers. We ask subordinates questions such as, is your manager modeling Intel values? Is he or she adding value to you and your team? This is valuable input for managers. We also ask the employees to coach managers on their professional development plans and actually evaluate their managers periodically on that plan. The manager essentially stands up in front of his subordinates and acknowledges what the employees feel are strengths, weaknesses, and areas for improvement. In a recent survey, 50% of managers with development plans involved their subordinates in the plan. The subordinates were part of the coaching mechanism to make the manager and the organization more effective. There's a lot more time and attention that goes into the selection process today at Intel. There are more people involved in the interview loop, including peers, team members, and subordinates. Before, the hiring manager was looking for a particular skill. Now, in addition to having the skills, we need someone who can interface well with other people because they are likely to work in a team. We also need someone who can thrive in the Intel environment where we are constantly moving resources. We used to define a job in terms of responsibilities, years of experience, and degrees held. Now we are including the expected deliverables the person must provide in the next 12 months. In this way, we can better identify and prioritize skills and experiences the candidate must have to get the results required. When you start with only the classic job description, oftentimes you hire somebody that really can't deliver the expected results. Even market leaders' new products won't sell if people don't understand them. In launching its third-generation microprocessor, the Intel 386, the company found people hesitant to switch from the earlier 286. Potential buyers didn't see what a successor chip offered that was new, so the company took to the streets to educate customers. It also found that appealing just to its direct buyers, the manufacturers of personal computers, wasn't enough. It had to talk directly to the end users. Today, Intel is still talking to end users. It targets different audiences with different messages. The results? Much faster sales. Says Dennis Carter, we are a product leader, so our marketing has two imperatives. First, we must create an understanding of the technology and how it fits into the marketplace as a whole. We have to make clear to customers the benefits of the new technology over the old. Second, we have to explain who Intel is and what we stand for. Successful as we have been, we can never take our credibility for granted. In general, we try to build marketing programs around some kind of long-term view. The best example of that is our Intel Insight marketing program, which defines those enduring who and what foundations of the company. The fundamental strategy of Intel Insight is to build an awareness of Intel and the role we play. We have been advertising more and more to end users since we launched the 386. And about the time the market shifted to the 386, we had to start selling the 486. It became very complex. That was when we realized that we needed to communicate something about what Intel stands for, our identity, and not just the product we were selling at the moment. So we started playing around with ideas that later turned into the Intel Insight program. Whenever we launch a new product, we must also spell out its benefits so end users will understand the new architecture, its attributes, and where it excels. However, this tactical short-term marketing must mesh with and reinforce our long-term goals of reinforcing Intel's identity. Our largest customer audience is made up of those who buy PCs for individual, mainly home use. They have another level of interest in the technology. They get a lot of that information at the retailers where they buy the product. Thus, being able to reach them with information at the point of sale is important. Some of our field sales force has been redeployed to call on resellers and supply them with educational information. We changed our audience's level of information acceptance. We succeeded in developing their expertise in listening and absorbing. Above all, our message is that we produce the best and the newest. Today, we are the absolute world leader in our product field. As veterans of Intel make clear, the company follows no simple formula to achieve product leadership. Multiple competencies, extending well beyond outstanding product design and manufacturing, have contributed to the company's earning its preeminent position in its industry. What helps Intel most to deftly ride the currents that swirl through its industry? Workers. managers, indeed an entire organization of people who are poised to change focus and direction in a snap. People throughout a company who can tackle tasks in a multidisciplinary fashion, often working near strangers on temporary teams. A self-correcting system in which all employees are dedicated to feeding back information on the company's internal and external performance. Designers who can maintain their focus on precise market need. In a marketing and sales organization that understands that customers need continual reminding of the value of buying machines with Intel Insight. It's a symphony, as Albert Yu says. No wonder the company is a leader in advanced technology in the field of PC microprocessors. And no wonder it is creating the architecture for tomorrow's and the day after's computer industry. Says Jerry Parker, I would submit that when we had to have some marketing brilliance, we got going on the Intel Insight program. When we had to learn how to manufacture advanced microprocessors, we got on with it. I suspect the right thing to do is to define your market and know exactly what you must do to be successful in it. You adjust your available resources to produce what will satisfy that market. The one who stays ahead of it and reacts to its changes almost before they happen is going to be the successful one, as opposed to the company that is just super good at what they are already doing.
Chapter 8, The Discipline of Customer Intimacy. Computer salespeople in the 1970s and 1980s, losing many a close sale to venerable IBM, often gave but one excuse. Nobody ever got fired for buying from IBM. Corporate America, it seems, was so convinced of IBM's technological mastery that computer chiefs, fearing a hearing with the boss if anything went wrong, dared not buy from any company with a less formidable reputation than IBM. The salespeople that lost out to IBM, however, indulged in false thinking. What they should have understood was that computer chiefs were not so much fearful of reprisal as they were happily dependent on the depth and range of services that IBM and IBM alone delivered. IBM CEO Thomas Watson, and later his CEO son Thomas Jr., had built that Rock of Gibraltar reputation by directing the gaze of his people to but one master, the customer. His unparalleled success in making IBM the source of expert advice on the use of business machines hobbled competitors for years. Although his company entered the computing industry later than many, it was soon to achieve dominance in the fastest-growing market on Earth. Think of IBM at the height of its market leadership in the 1970s. What did it stand for? The best product? Not in many people's minds. Although its products performed solidly, they usually did not come with the benefit of the latest innovations. For the up-to-the-second advances, customers had to turn to IBM's competitors, which pioneered online operating systems, virtual memory, mini-computers, and most other breakthrough capabilities. IBM was an adopter of these innovations, but not often the leader. Did IBM offer the best price? Hardly. It left that to other companies that knocked off its designs. IBM's unmatched value was not in product or price, but in the extraordinary level of service, guidance, expertise, and hand-holding it offered clients rocked by the turbulent changes in information technology. To the data processing chiefs at many companies, IBM was a total solution. It offered methods for planning new business applications, for training development staff, and for managing data. It helped these chiefs explain to senior management the need for a steadily increasing budget. It pitched in when a system wasn't working, diagnosing the problem and getting it back on track. It took care of planning which new machines were needed, which had to be upgraded, and how to integrate new technology. It sent clients off for periodic education to deepen their technical knowledge and broaden their managerial skills. In the 1970s, you might say the data processing chief's job in many companies was well near impossible without the support of IBM. Thomas Watson's success was built on offering an unmatched total solution in the marketplace, delivered through an operating model tuned completely to that purpose. His focus and dedication have been emulated by many customer-intimate market leaders today. Of course, more recently, IBM has lost its way. It has gotten a black eye from customers that believe it has been overexploiting its long-standing client relationships. It moved too cautiously toward newer concepts of computing, in part because it had not maintained parity in product innovation. Rather than mining for untapped potential, it became stuck trying to exploit its old solutions to clients' old and new problems. This is hardly a position from which to maintain customer intimacy. The Rock of Gibraltar that was once IBM has turned, probably forever, to shale. Its glorious history and painful decline offer important lessons in both how to and how not to succeed as a customer-intimate company. When we talk of companies offering the best total solution, we mean that although they don't necessarily offer the lowest price or the latest product features, they still provide a better overall result for their clients than anyone else. They do that by attending to a much broader range of their clients' needs. The lowest price or the best product isn't the best value if the client doesn't know how to use the product effectively, fails to fix its broken management processes, or lacks the skills to achieve optimal results. Customer intimate companies are unmatched at addressing all of these client limitations. The most common characteristic of customer intimate companies is that they offer a unique range of superior services, from education to hands-on help, so that customers can get the most out of their products. Home Depot and Nordstrom, for instance, continually surprise customers with knowledgeable, caring, and unhurried sales personnel, who give sage advice about the products and their application, whether it's replacing a broken light switch or assembling a wardrobe. Their competitive advantage is found in their people, who leave customers wondering, why can't other retailers offer me the same level of personalized attention? Customer intimate companies personalize basic services and even customize products to meet unique customer needs. Airborne Express, for instance, continually surprises its customers with tailored solutions that competitors can't match. Exceptionally early delivery, same-day courier service, special handling of windshields and vaccines. Although such services are often out of the question for their competitors, they are routine for Airborne. Similarly, Cable and Wireless, the Great Britain-based telecommunications company, offers its clients customized networks and service features that couldn't be obtained from MCI or British Telecom. Its customers marvel. How can such a large company craft a solution that meets my unusual needs? For a customer-intimate company, it's all in a day's work. Other stars of this discipline go even further, helping revamp the client's business processes that involve the use of their product. Milwaukee, Wisconsin-based Johnson Controls, for example, provides its building management clients with experts in energy use, who offer plans that can change building design and management. A.G. Edwards, the stock brokerage firm, trains its brokers not to push particular securities, but to work with its clients to clarify life objectives. Put kids through college, care for parents, enjoy comfortable retirement. To construct an achievable plan and develop in the client a discipline to stay the course. Kott Corporation has achieved spectacular success in the private label soda business, not solely by offering inexpensive soda, but by partnering with supermarket retailers to change the basic processes by which private label products are managed, marketed, and sold. Another element that customer-intimate companies stress is a willingness to take on responsibility for achieving results. They will often put themselves at risk to further their client's success. They will even take full responsibility for an operation and deliver a guaranteed result. Roadway Logistics Systems, for example, has taken over all responsibility for inbound logistics at two Ford assembly plants. Hundreds of component suppliers, 14 transportation companies, and all warehouses are managed by Roadway Logistics to achieve just-in-time delivery. Ford gets the result without any need to transform warehousing, scheduling, or freight management. These are now completely Roadway Logistics problems. Similarly, Baxter International's hospital supply unit is continuing to take over the job of managing supplies for its customers. For a fixed fee per patient day, Baxter now provides all the basic supplies to a hospital and takes responsibility for managing inventory and logistics right down to the nursing station and the supply cabinet. Baxter also takes responsibility for shrinkage. The system is up and operating at over 400 hospitals already. Baxter's customer-intimate approach is sure to keep shaking things up in the hospital supply distribution business. Some of these companies have taken the art of customer intimacy even farther. While companies such as IBM have focused on helping clients better use products, many companies have found other components of best total solution at which to excel. Toronto-based Kott Corporation, which makes private label soft drinks, was asked by Safeway Supermarkets for help in marketing its store brand line of soda pop. Kott saw that Safeway needed to do more than simply revive sluggish cola sales. It needed to improve the performance of all its private label products. Kott suggested alternative approaches to package design, merchandising, promotion, and production formulation. Kott even showed Safeway how its idle bottling plant capacity could be used to make product for other Kott clients. In true customer-intimate fashion, Kott was able to look beyond a simple syrup and water solution, beyond a standard offering which would have been enough to satisfy Safeway, and instead offer a total solution to Safeway's needs. Safeway and Kott both derive greater value from the resulting relationship. Kott's customized solution extends to marketing. Rather than follow the lead of Coke and Pepsi, which pour hundreds of millions of dollars into brand advertising, Kott is extremely selective with its promotions. It spent just $2 million to launch the Safeway program, but it also enlisted the help of the people who could be most effective in selling the cola, Safeway employees. Kott reminded them that private label soda helps preserve Safeway's profit margins and their jobs. The cola Kott gave the Safeway workers convinced them that it tasted good, good enough to recommend. In effect, Kott created 76,000 new salespeople for Safeway Select Soda and achieved a stunning 35% market share within 4 months of introduction. Working similarly with Walmart, Kott achieved and has maintained a nearly 50% market share for Sam's American Choice Cola, against product leaders Coke and Pepsi. Successful customer-intimate companies are those that have become expert at their customers' business and at creating solutions. But no matter what their formula for combining help in using the product, advice on transforming the underlying processes, and responsibility for achieving results, these companies deploy an operating model based on design principles very much like those followed by Thomas Watson. Watson's business was highly client-driven. It was proactive, change-oriented, and proud of its superior knowledge of the application of its products. IBM measured its success by its client's success. Complex solutions were crafted and integrated by sophisticated account teams and dozens of specialized service and product support groups. The result? A total solution tailored and coordinated by a dedicated account team and efficiently delivered through selected specialized experts. Current thinking on matrix and team-based management owes a large debt to Thomas Watson. Watson knew that he didn't have a chance without deep knowledge of his clients. He built the best-trained sales and service force that the world had ever seen. He aggressively invested in new practices, new ideas, and new approaches to the application and management of business machines. The result was that IBM's thinking about the best use of its products was generally two steps ahead of its clients. IBM could attack the root causes of a problem while the client was still focused on the symptoms. Deep customer knowledge and breakthrough insights about the client's underlying processes are the backbone of every customer-intimate organization today. It's not by accident that Cott is investing heavily in new approaches to supermarket category management, that Roadway Logistics has hired and developed savvy logistics talent to rival any consulting firm, that Baxter International knows more about the use and management of supplies in a hospital than any of its clients, or that Zeppelin, the German distributor of Caterpillar earth-moving equipment, knows more about the effective management of heavy equipment than a highway construction company could possibly hope to. Every one of these companies has built a body of expertise in account teams and specialized service groups that is the foundation for customer-intimate relationships. But becoming and staying customer-intimate requires more than building client knowledge and having expertise in re-engineering client business processes. Watson believed that to be effective, one must offer more than just service. He maintained a very broad product line that was configurable to the specific needs of a client. His products may not always have had the latest features, but he knew that an average product tailored to a client's very specific needs is often better than the most advanced but inflexible product. Organizations like Watson's are not obsessed by the leading edge. They embrace solid, tested products that can be tailored to fit clients' needs like a glove. They produce unmatched value for clients who don't necessarily want the very latest product, just the best result and help in obtaining it. Since customer-intimate organizations mold themselves to their customers' needs, an extraordinary variety of activity is always percolating across a broad set of accounts. This creates a laboratory for developing better application support, for discovering new process improvements, and for testing new kinds of relationships where responsibility increasingly shifts from client to supplier. Watson knew that a decentralized organization better achieved tight relationships with clients. He understood the importance of empowerment and the critical role of individual initiative. He summed it up in a one-word motto, think, and disciplined his sales support and service forces to live the motto every day in their interactions with clients. As IBM grew and grew, Watson maintained a rigid focus on account control. His management system was based on detailed measurement of account penetration. He focused his control system not on profitability or market share, but on share of customer spending. Every customer-intimate company knows that the critical objective is share of client. The worst failure in a customer-intimate organization isn't to lose money, it is to lose a client. Client by client, Thomas Watson set targets for penetration, development, and growth. As far back as 1924, he hired R.L. Polk Company to use its city maps, directories, and other proprietary data to find specific potential customer accounts. Polk helped to identify the character and potential of more than 2 million of them. To operate this type of control system, one needs specific, detailed, and integrated customer data. Operationally excellent companies may be able to tell you a lot about their transactions, but customer-intimate ones have computer systems that can tell you a lot about their customers. This is especially important when it's not one person, but a team of people that serve an account. For more than 30 years, IBM's competitors were endlessly frustrated by Watson's success. Many of them tried to adopt his approach, but failed, because they thought IBM's success stemmed from the sales and service force. These wannabes let product development and manufacturing continue on their course, while their field forces labored mightily to become intimate. It didn't work. Customer intimacy, as Watson built it and others have discovered, requires the efforts of the whole company. Sure, the banner carriers are sales and service people, but without the complete alignment of product development, manufacturing, administrative functions, and senior management, one can't achieve a total solution for customers.